Well, it's now time for our Sunday morning Q&A. Joining us this morning is State Comptroller Peter Franchot. Good morning.
Thank you. Good morning, Barry. How are you?
Plenty of things to talk about. I'm fine. Plenty of things to talk about. First, let's deal with the collecting of unpaid taxes.
Right.
The system that's doing that.
Well, first of all, we really want to reward people that do the right thing, pay their taxes on time, just by leaving them alone. I'm in favor of not increasing taxes, but we also want to be fair and make sure that people that cheat on taxes, that we find them when we collect what's owed the state. So we have a new technology system called MITS. It's almost paid for itself, even though it was pretty expensive in the short term, and it's going to, we think, substantially increase our ability to get the tax revenue that's owed the state under existing tax laws. And everyone should be in favor of that, because nobody wants someone to take advantage and not pay their obligation.
And this is money that's owed to the state anyway.
So money that's owed to the state. We've collected over $1 billion in the last 4 years in delinquent taxes, and it's important to do that to level the playing field and keep everybody playing by the same rules. But I emphasize that it's the existing tax law. I'm not in favor of increasing new taxes.
Okay. Administrative sloppiness.
Yes.
Tough words from you dealing with the Department of Juvenile Services. What's that all about?
Well, I'm on the Board of Public Works with the governor and the treasurer. My role is to be a fiscal advocate, a fiscal watchdog. This agency came to us and tried to get $171 million in contracts approved for work that had already been done. And I put my hand up and protested and said, how do the taxpayers know they get a good deal if after the fact we're approving the contracts and the contracts are not competitively bid? So I raised a stink there, and I think it's appropriate to put your hand up and say, are the taxpayers getting a good deal?
Do you think that that also led to the resignation recently of the secretary, Donald DeVore?
The next day, they announced that he was leaving, and I have no idea whether that had anything to do with it, but it's a serious issue, and these are fiscal problems opposed to policy issues that agency is has faced.
Okay. Well, let's get to a couple of the questions that we have. One is dealing with the energy drinks that are filled with caffeine and alcohol.
Right.
And you got into this fight. Why did you get into this? That's one of the questions.
Well, I'm the chief regulator of the alcohol industry in the state. I have an enforcement division that goes out and regulates from the state level our role as far as making sure that liquor is taxed properly. So I have a big role to play as the regulator. I was pleased in this instance, because it's a dangerous product, to go to the industry itself, the alcohol industry, and they agreed, Barry, with us that it was dangerous and took a voluntary recall. Excuse me. And I think this is commendable, because it showed they're good corporate citizens. You get speedy, effective action. Doesn't cost the taxpayers any money to go out and do extra inspections. And I think it's a preferred route in this particular instance. It's very sensible and common sense approach. And I'm delighted that the industry rose up and said, you know what, this is a product that we think is dangerous. We're going to voluntarily recall it, and we're not going to sell it anymore in the state of Maryland. And I think that's a very positive conclusion.
But you still have some stores that are still saying, well, we're going to sell our supply, and if we can get more, then we'll try to do it, because it is voluntary.
Yeah, but the key here is that, unlike government action, which has murky legal aspects and has a delay and you get all sorts of administrative headaches, and it's adversarial by nature, this is something the industry partnered with the state and said, we're going to do it. It's speedy, it's effective, it's not foolproof. Obviously, there'll be some instances of things falling through the cracks, but 99.9% of the problem has been taken care of. We should move on to the next problem.
Okay. Well, let's move on to our next question then, as we try to deal with that. The next question is, does the state of Maryland have any plans to take action against the Commonwealth of Virginia for poaching on Maryland tax revenue?
Well, I think that person that raised that issue should call me at 410-260-7801 tomorrow. Call me in the office. I'll take the call. And we'll get our experts to look at this. We don't get better if we don't listen to complaints and criticism like this. If, in fact, we're overlooking something, we should act on it. I'm not exactly sure of all the specifics,
right.
So I'd really like your questioner, to call our office tomorrow, and we'll get to the bottom of it and get him an answer.
Okay.
If he doesn't like the answer, he can come back on the next show.
He sent us another letter.
Yeah.
We can ask you again. All right. One of the other issues that has been very important in the state of Maryland, and recently passed a referendum dealing with slots. This was an issue that was kind of thorny for you as well.
Right. No, I think it's obviously overall, I think slots are a bad idea for the state, but the voters spoke and now we're trying to implement it. The problem is it's like a three-ring circus and it's just going to get worse. It's very concerning to me when we're asked to spend $800 million of taxpayers' money to buy the slot machines for the gambling companies. No other state does that. Maybe our streets are paved in gold. Who knows? But I think there are going to be lots of problems, more problems to come as far as slots, because we're simply not implementing the program in a good way.
One of the other issues was, the casino having a temporary facility. That wasn't something that, were you aware of that at first or not?
No, but even people that are pro slots are saying they don't like these slots parlors and they continue to go to West Virginia and Delaware. So the whole concept is just flawed. And it's very sad that we spend so much time on gambling. It takes money largely from poor people, economically challenged people, and it's a lousy way to get revenue for the state. And we seem to be mesmerized by it. I'm hoping that all of the corruption problems that other states have when they bring gambling like this in do not come to Maryland, but okay. You know, we'll see.
All right, thanks a lot.
Yeah, great seeing you. Thank you very much.
Maryland State Comptroller Peter Franchot, thank you for being with us. And a week from today, our guest will be Howard County Executive Ken Ullman. If you have a question for the county executive, send it to Sunday questions at WBALTV.com. Again, that's Sunday questions at WBALTV.com.